So in the last lesson, we talked about some aspects related to controlling. We understood what exactly is controlling, what is the meaning of controlling, what are the functions of management, and where does controlling stand. The cycle of planning, organizing, staffing, directing, and controlling. And we also talked about functions within controlling, which are important. And I took an example of Coke manufacturing plant to explain to you what exactly is controlling and how is it carried out. If you have not seen that last session, please go and watch it before moving forward to the second session. In this particular section, I'm going to talk about number one, nature of control function, and then we'll move forward and create a sequence of topics under control to be discussed. Believe me, it is a very important topic, and we are expecting a good number of questions in the upcoming examination. So the first one is nature of control function. What is the nature? What is the feature of control function? Everything that you talk about, everybody that you talk about has a nature, has a personality. Control function also has a personality, has a specific set of features that are important to remember. Number one is end function. End function means that it comes towards the end. Very easy to understand, no rocket science here. I have already explained planning, organizing, staffing, directing, and controlling. Controlling comes towards the end, which comes after all the management functions are done and performance is made. Very simple nature to understand. Pervasive function. Pervasive function means that it exists at all levels and in all types of concerns. Whether it's a service industry, whether it's a manufacturing plant, whether it's agriculture industry, whether it's photography, whether it's videography, whether it's education, in everything that you do, and it all in all levels of the organization, whether it's top, medium, or low level of the organization, control exists. So control is pervasive, is found everywhere. Pervasive means is found everywhere. Without control function, you cannot understand why humans or why any person or anything is doing something which is not expected or which is different from the standard which has been set. Okay? Or even if a person or a thing, let's say, is performing beyond the standard or above the standard, then you know that something is wrong with the standard. So pervasiveness of control helps you understand and makes the organizations better. Okay? Dynamic process. Dynamic means it has to keep changing. Not only the control function, but also the functions within control function. Whether it's standards, standards also need to change if they are not in line with the present scenario. The actual performance needs to change every day if it is not in line with the standards and not in line with the environment that it is surrounded by. Everything that comes under control has to be dynamic, has to be flexible to changes that are happening in the external and internal environment. Since management runs a business whose external environment keeps on changing, therefore control function also needs to be dynamic. Let's say I'm into education, and let's say I put a control measure on my team members saying that every one of us, including me, have to create 40 pages per day. Okay. My employees, my team members say, okay, that's your control method, 40 pages per day. But the quality of these 40 pages, let's say, goes down. Quality goes down because I'm demanding too much. Let's say the most efficient coverage should be 20 pages per day. And it should not be even considered or measured in terms of pages. So the quality goes down because now the focus has shifted from what you are writing to how much are you writing. So you're writing, if you're writing 40 pages per day, producing 40 pages per day, nothing is wrong. You are a efficient and a star performer. Does not matter whether your quality is good or bad. That is directly going to affect the quality, and that is directly going to affect the learning that students will have. And if the learning of students is affected, that will directly have an impact on the following that I have in the public scenario, in the public arena. Okay, students will stop following me, students will stop liking me just because the quality is not as good as they expect out of me. Okay, so it has to be a dynamic function, which means it has to keep changing according to demands of the external environment. Continuous function. Control also involves constant analysis of validity of standards, policies, procedures, etc. It's a continuous function, which means that it never stops. Control is pervasive, which means it is present everywhere and in all organizations. Continuous means that it never stops. It keeps on going forward and forward. So even when you are involving in planning function, does not mean that controlling function is not working. Simultaneously, in the background, controlling function is also working. So controlling function is all continuous. It keeps on going once the organization starts working. So taking the education example again, I have a team of, let's say, 4 people, me and 3 more people. Whatever they do, I check their work. Now that is a part of control, and that is a continuous function, because every day I'm going to check their performance and measure whether it is at par with the standards or not. So it's a continuous function. It never stops. Action oriented. The purpose of control is achieved only when corrective action is taken on the basis of feedback information. Action oriented means that control function is not complete if you don't take any action on the feedback that you have received. Let's say the standard was 120 bottles per day in the Coke example that I took in the last class. My performance is 100 per day, 100 bottles per day of Coke or Coca-Cola. Now I have realized, and my superior has understood, that there is a deviation of 20 per day, but he still does not know what is the reason behind this deviation. Is the problem with me or is the problem with the standard? He will identify where the problem lies, number one. When he has identified where the problem lies, then he will try and see what the problem is. If the problem is with me, what is the reason that my performance is not in line with the standards? So he will identify what the problem is, and then he will take a feedback action, which means he will try and plug this hole. He will try and fill this gap and try and take me to the standard of 120 per day. And when he is taking this feedback action, that makes control function action oriented. I hope you have understood this as well. Let's move forward. The link between controlling and planning. This is very interesting and very confusing for a lot of students. Therefore, watch it and listen to it very carefully. Now, you know that planning comes first, then you have organizing, then you have staffing, then you have directing, and then you have controlling. Okay? Controlling is the last function and planning was the first function. So what can be the link between the last function and the first function? These are the three linkages which are created. When plan becomes operation, control function starts to measure progress, to uncover deviations and take corrective actions. So planning is like envisioning, like APJ Abdul Kalam, let's say he comes and says, I want India to go to Mars by 2022. That's the plan that you have. That's the vision based on which you create a plan. Now controlling function will be to measure the progress. Let's say 2021 December, there is a meeting in which you try and see whether the progress achieved on this plan is sufficient or not, whether there are any deviations or not, what are the deviations, and then you take corrective actions under this control function. So controlling function has a direct relation with the planning function. Without good plan, there cannot be an effective control system. Let's say the plan says Mars by December 2019. This is the plan. Right now we are in June 2019. You have only 6 months till you create an aircraft and a technology which can help you go to Mars by 2019 December. And it takes more than 8 months to reach Mars. So the plan is unrealistic. The plan is not good. It's a bad plan, which cannot be realized or which cannot be achieved at all, whatever the organization might do. So it's not a good plan. Without good plan, there cannot be an effective control system. Because the plan is not good, it's not going to be realized at all or materialized at all in the future. Therefore, there will never be an effective control system. The third one is the most important, based on which questions might come in the examination. Planning without control is meaningless, and control without planning is blind. How do you explain this? Planning without control is meaningless. So this means that you have a plan which is mass, reach mass by 2022, but there is no control mechanism in place. So even when you are sitting on the verge of, you know, failing in that plan, let's say December 2021, and there is no control mechanism, so you don't know whether your plan is going to be successful or not, why it might fail, and what are the corrective actions that you need to ensure that it does not fail. There is no control mechanism here. That means the plan that you made has been termed or has been rendered meaningless because you don't have a control mechanism. You're not able to see how are you performing on that plan you have made. You're never going to reach it. Even if you reach it, you're never going to be efficient. You're not never going to be satisfactory. Therefore, it is a meaningless exercise. It does not make any sense. On the other hand, you have a control mechanism. You have a control mechanism that 2021, we will sit and see whether we can achieve or we can reach mass by 2022 or not. But there was no plan. There was no plan in place. You had this control mechanism. You suddenly in December 2021, you call a meeting, high level meeting of all the major ministers and the scientists, and you ask them, are you going to be able to reach mass by 2022 end or not? And the scientists say, there was no plan in first place. We were never told that we have to create something so that we can reach mass by 2022. So there was no plan. It was all control. They just came together and they decided to have a meeting and see whether it's doable or not. So control without planning is blind. It's completely blind because the reason being that you don't know what you are required to do, and you suddenly come together and decide to control, decide to see what your performance has been so far. No plan, only control means blindness. Plan, no control means meaninglessness. Okay, these are very important keywords that you have to remember. Please do not forget these keywords. Let's come to the next topic. Benefits of effective control system. I believe, I'm very sure with whatever I have taught you, you must now be very thorough with how control system works and what are the benefits that control system can help you achieve. Number one, coordination. In organizations, there are many units producing and distributing different products. In order to coordinate their activities, efficient system of control is necessary. So, coordination, as I had explained, post-corb, which was given by Arvik and Gulick, divided control into three parts. Okay, one of them was coordination. CO stood for coordination. So, coordination here means a level of understanding between different departments, between different people of the same departments, and a good understanding or coordination in the entire organization. So there are different departments, different units which work in an organization, and in order to ensure that one unit, that the entire control system is effective, you need to ensure first of all that these different units are in coordination with each other. If these units are not in coordination with each other, the plan is never going to be realized, the control will never be effective. Okay, let me take an example and explain it to you. Let's say you are working, or let's say I am working, let me put the blade on me. Let's say I am working in a Maruti, let's say I am working in Maruti assembly plant, wherein there are, let's say, five units or five departments. Okay, five departments. Number one department is, let's say, the engine department, which provides me with the engines. Second department is, let's say, the outer body department, which provides me the outer body. Third one is the, let's say, paint department, which paints all the vehicles. Fourth department is, let's say, what else do we create? Let's say tires department, okay, provides tires. And number five, let's say, bolts department. So bolts department needs to be connected directly with the tires department, with the outer body department, as well as with the engine department. So strong coordination between, on the outside only, we have seen the strong coordination between some of these departments is required. On the other hand, if you want to create one car, you need all these departments to work in sync with each other. You require an outer body at first. Then you will put engine in it. then you will bolt it, then again you will put tires in it, then you will bolt it, then at the end you will paint the entire body along with everything inside. Okay, so if you want to achieve this objective of creating cars after cars, you need to create the right sync between these departments, and coordination needs to be perfect. Okay, so that is one of the major benefits of effective control system. If you have a good control system, coordination automatically comes. Corrective action, I believe that's self-satisfactory. If you do not have a control system, you are unable to take the corrective action that is required. Decision making. Control is needed in making subsequent decisions as to what types of follow-up actions are to be taken. If you do not have a control system, you don't know whatever you did in planning, organizing, staffing and directing POSD, whether it was effective or not, whether it helped us achieve the objectives that we wanted to achieve or not, whether we need to make any changes in the way we move forward with the same targets again and again or not. So all these decision making exercises are possible only when you have an effective control system. And the last is supervision. Control facilitates supervision. Supervision means to identify, to supervise over other people, to lead over other people, and to ensure that everybody is doing as they are or he or she is told, and to point out deviations. It keeps subordinates under check and bring discipline among them. Because if you're working in, let's say, a manufacturing plant, you have to ensure that there are disciplined supervisors who are able to understand subordinates' needs, but also at the same time inculcate certain discipline in them and ensure that they complete their targets on a daily basis. So supervision is possible only when you have effective control system. So in this case, my supervision was 120 bottles per day, my performance was 100 per day, and the supervisor was able to identify that I'm not achieving the objective only because there was a predetermined standard. If this predetermined standard was not available, then supervision would not have been that effective. He would feel that 100 per day is good enough, there is no problem, and I would go on working inefficiently. Okay, so this is all about this particular lesson. In the next lesson, I'm going to take it forward, talk about limitations of control, and then we'll talk about a lot of other things. And finally, we'll take some practice questions to understand what kind of questions and how can questions be asked in the examination from control.